Well, John Counsell, welcome to the AOPA Pilot Lounge. We're delighted to have you here. You've got one of the most remarkable stories I've ever heard in aviation. A first officer with Alaskan Airlines, and of course that comes after a 20-year career with the Air Force flying fighters, which is what we're going to talk about today. You have one of the most remarkable stories I've ever heard in aviation. You've been flying really all your life, but you started flying for the Air Force, went through pilot training, got an F-15, and then you were in F-15 upgrade training when you had your incident and survived a high-speed ejection. Do you mind telling us, sharing that story with us?
I don't mind at all there, Spad. You know, it's been told in a lot of different forms over the years, and there's something I think that I can relate to anybody. And right now, as we're going through this challenge across not only the United States, but the entire world, and people are facing setbacks and challenges that they've never dreamt they would ever have to deal with, I think there's some good lessons that hopefully I can pass on from that experience and help everybody out there that is listening in AOPA.
Tell us the story. What happened?
All right. Well, we're going to go back to May of 1994. I was 26-year-old, first lieutenant in the United States Air Force. And I'd been fortunate enough to fly the F-15C, which, as we know, is the world's greatest air superiority fighter. 103.5 wins to zero, the only fighter jet that can ever say that. And I know you are a proud part of that community as well. We were going out on what we call mission qual training, which was at the very end of our top off for learning to fly and employ or fight with the F-15C. I was down at Tyndall Air Force Base in Panama City, Florida. And we stepped to the jet for me to fly what was called a defensive BFM ride. BFM stands for Basic Fighter Maneuvers. This is what everybody knows is the good old classic dogfight. And just like you do an exercise in football, maybe it's a blocking drill or a dribbling drill in basketball, the way we practice a lot of the fundamentals in dogfighting, as you know, was we would do what's called perch setups, where we would take the two jets and set them up at a known distance, at a known set of parameters, altitude, airspeed, and angles off of the tail, either 3,000, 6,000, or 9,000 feet behind the other airplane, and we would start our basic dogfight training at that point. This ride for me was the first time that I was now facing an instructor pilot who was not going to have any limitations on his airplane as a training aid. What that means is he was going to use the full thrust potential, the full maneuverability potential of the jet. Luckily, you know, you've been an instructor, I've been an instructor. We know he wasn't going to use all his tricks because I was a brand new guy. It wasn't going to be that hard to probably teach this guy a lesson. And his job there was still to make sure I was doing things fundamentally sound while giving me a little more challenging problem. Well, as you know, dogfighting is a very strenuous activity. And there are some threats that come from flying fourth and now fifth generation fighters. When you go all the way back to about 1920 is the first time we started to notice a physiological situation that would affect pilots. And that's called G-induced loss of consciousness. And what happened that day, Spad, was we had gone through four or five fights prior to the mishap engagement. And I had been making some basic mistakes that a lot of the new guys in the F-15 make. One of my defensive maneuvers, what we call a ditch, the timing was about a second to half a second late. And you and I think that, wow, that's a big gap. For people in normal life, a half second judgment in looking over your shoulder at 7-8 Gs trying to analyze a jet that's going 400 mile an hour behind you and he's maybe a half mile away, a half second seems pretty precise, but when you're competing against somebody with the skills that we compete against every day, and fighter training really is competition, I was just not quite performing the way I wanted to. And so my instructor that day was Ken Spitter Swallow. Great guy. I still keep in touch with Spitter. And he went on the defense. I went on the offensive side, so I was starting this engagement back behind him, and he was going to demonstrate the timing and the angle aspect that he wanted me to finesse.
I got it. That's interesting. I didn't know that part of the story. It was a defensive ride, but your instructor's looking at it saying, hey, I see some mistakes here. and I want to demonstrate what the proper maneuver and the proper timing. So you were actually on the offensive perch. So for our audience there, you're maybe a 30 to 45 degree cone, 6 to 9,000 feet behind the defender as you're going to start the engagement there.
Correct. And Spitter, I was actually reviewing some of his statements from the accident board today. And he says in there, he goes, I've seen where I could fix this problem easiest in the past because it's a common problem that newer guys flying defensive BFM and any jet have. He goes, I've found success where if I go demonstrate one, it picks up easier. It also gives the guy a break, gives him not only a physical break, but a little bit of a mental break. Because
I can just add to this, Jughead, for people to understand, to the fact that you had already gone through 4 or 5 defensive perch setups. Those are exhausting. You're sitting in your airplane, you're looking back over your shoulder, your body's twisted all around. And as you start this engagement, you immediately pull the jet into as close to 9 G's as you can get it without over G'ing. And you're going to hold that for a long time while you're doing your anti-G straining maneuver. And you get in these more advanced maneuvers over and over again. 4 or 5 defensive perch setups is exhausting. And I look back on it and think, we used to do that all the time.
We did, you know, and if you go back and if you study G-induced loss of consciousness and the factors that contribute to it, it's everything that we do in daily fighter flying. It's multiple engagements. We don't have the gas and the resources just to go fight once or twice. When we get out there, we fly until we are absolutely out of gas. We are flying in hot, humid environments in a lot of our locations, which obviously Florida was. We do multiple engagements. We have mental tasks. I always explain dogfighting was kind of like taking a calculus test in the middle of a rugby game, because it was just as physically demanding as it was mentally. And either one of those, if they weren't at 100%, you were going to give something up to your dogfighting partner.
Yeah. Okay. So he's going to demonstrate to you, he puts you back on the offensive perch and he's going to demonstrate the timing of this ditch maneuver. So pick it up from there.
So we're going to go in, I'm going to count down 8,000, 7,000, 6,000 fights on. We're going to take the left hand, plug it into full afterburner on both Pratt & Whitney 100 engines. All 5 stages are going to light. We're doing about 440 knots when we call fights on. The defender is immediately going to go into his brake turn. It's going to be about an 8G brake turn. I'm going to have to unload and drive for just about a second to where I get to where the other jet was when he started his brake turn. We call that driving to the turn circle. When I get there, I roll to the left. It's a left-hand fight. It's funny. I always tell it to the right. I think it's mainly because of how my injuries were at the time, and it's just natural for us to shoot our watch, which is on my left hand. But it was actually a left-hand turn in engagement. I'll roll to the left. I'll sit my left lift vector onto the other F-15 and start to execute my brake turn. As you know, in the F-15, we have the overload warning system. It's a series of beeps and tones that tell you when you're starting to approach maximum G. At 92% of max G, you get a single rate beeper. At 90, I think it's 96, you get double rate beeper. And about 98, you get solid tone. Well, as a student, you never want to over G because that's an automatic taco or bust the ride. So we're usually pretty conservative, trying to get into the 7.5 to 8 G region of the brake turn. I'll go ahead, execute my brake turn. I will notice that it is not quite as good a brake turn as the bandit that I'm fighting, which our turn circles are going to become misaligned slightly. And we won't go into all the geometry here without a whiteboard up here to draw it for everybody in about 6 months to explain the aerodynamics. But what it means is I have to unload the jet and drive again after about 180 degrees a turn. I'm going to unload the jet, drive straight for about another second. Well, when you unload a jet, you take the angle of attack off of it. You take the G's off of it. The jet starts to accelerate, and it accelerates at its fastest rate when you do that. And it doesn't matter if it's a jet or if it's your 180 or any other airplane. When I get to this secondary turn circle, and I'm going to do what we call a tighten down or a secondary brake, what I don't know, and this is one of the first lessons that I transfer to anybody when I tell this story, was I was not aware of the energy state on my airplane. And what I mean by that, and it's funny, you were a safety officer. It wasn't until I went to safety school and read my own safety report did I know the exact initial root cause that led to the chain of events that caused me to have to jump out of my jet. But because my initial brake turn was slightly weaker, I didn't bleed off as many Gs. So typically we would start the flight at 440 knots. A good hard G brake turn would bring us down into the 360 to 380 knot region. When I unloaded and had to accelerate to get to his turn circle, my jet got even faster than I was expecting it to. And we already talked about how physically demanding the G loads are. I cannot do a max performance G strain every time I pull back on the stick, because all I will do is completely exhaust my body, get dehydrated, get sweaty, even more sweaty than normal flying F-15s, and get worn out. So what you do is you strain for as many G's as you expect to be pulling. Well, this day, when I got to my secondary brake turn, I had an extra 40 knots of energy on the jet, about 10% more energy than I expected, Spad. So when I pulled back on that stick expecting to be about a 6.5 G secondary brake turn, I ended up having enough energy or airspeed to pull 7.5 G's. Even though I was straining, it wasn't enough. Fatigue started to catch up to me as I'm sustaining this 7.5 G's in the secondary brake turn, and I'll end up putting myself to sleep or unconscious due to the G-forces. Now, when this happens, Spitter has already basically started to do what we call a ditch, which is kind of looks like an Immelmann, rolls inverted and pulls right back into my jet's position, trying to develop a three-dimensional problem for me to solve. He instantly sees that I am no longer maneuvering in relation to him, and his mind starts to try to process why. At first, he's thinking, well, I told him just to sit and watch when I executed this maneuver. So he may just be sitting up there watching it. And he's thinking to himself, okay, it's now time to call the knock it off, which is our term we use to stop the fighting. And within about a half a second, he quickly realizes this is not a case of him just flying up above me watching. His jet is now going in a straight line. And as you remember back in our fighter training, we would see lots of training videos and safety videos talking about G-induced loss of consciousness. We've seen the HUD tapes, the heads-up display tapes. And we've seen the radar tapes of showing jets where they quit maneuvering because the pilot's gone unconscious. And Spitter said in his mind, about a half second after that initial thought, he knew I was unconscious, and every one of those videos he had ever seen started coming back through his mind. Now, 2 years before me, we had another young F-15 pilot, very similar situation, woke up from a G-induced loss of consciousness over the Gulf of Mexico. Of course, you're over water, very little depth perception, tough to tell your altitude. And when you've been unconscious for anywhere from 15 to 30 seconds, you don't have all your normal mental, let alone physical capacities. This young man had enough airspeed on the jet that when he woke up, he tried to save the jet to keep from hitting the water. He successfully did that, but at 15 Gs, he physically snapped both wings off the jet. Unfortunately, his subsequent ejection attempt was not successful. Rest his soul, but we talked about that every day. And, you know, the lesson in the brief was, if you find yourself nose low over the water, don't rip the wings off the jet trying to save it. So I'm going to spend the next 24 seconds with the airplane unloaded to basically zero G and a little more than 90 degrees, a left-hand bank with my nose pointed 10 to 15 degrees below the horizon initially. As this jet continues to accelerate, it will now accelerate at its fastest physical limits, and the nose will continue to fall downhill. Now, Spad,
you're still in full afterburner, right?
I'm still cooking in both motors, buddy. Heck yeah, speed is life, right? Spitter will instantly get turned around. He's going to be calling for a knock it off on the radio. Of course, I don't answer it, being unconscious. He'll use our call sign that day, which was Mach flight. That's kind of a bummer call sign that day. Mach knock it off, Mach 1 knock it off, nothing out of me. He then will start using my individual personal call sign, which back then was Moose, because he knows that if he starts talking to me, I'm more likely to hear that and recognize that. So he starts calling for Moose to knock it off, no answer. He
and then starts you guys, trying... you, I'm sorry to interrupt you, John. You guys started this engagement around 20,000 feet, right? So you're probably now going through what, 17, 16, maybe 15,000 feet, full afterburner, accelerating 15 degrees nose low in a slightly left bank.
It's a lot of left bank. Everything else is pretty accurate there, Spad, but the nose is continuing to point further and further nose low because obviously gravity is pulling it down. I am also now walking away from Spitter. I've got over 250 more knots than he has, and I'm out accelerating him. He has me locked up on his radar, and what he does, he starts telling me to fly my airplane. He starts telling me roll wings level, pull the power back, pull your nose up. And the reason he does that, for all our viewers out there, is when you start to wake up from a G-induced loss of consciousness, the first thing that you'll start to regain is your eyesight, then your hearing, and then you'll start to get rough motor skills, i.e. I can make major muscle movements, but I can't finesse the airplane. So he's trying to fly the airplane for me through my ears. Back then, the ACES II ejection seat, we had a minimum out-of-control ejection altitude of 10,000 feet. As you and I know, the ejection seat and the equipment is incredibly capable. The number one reason fighter pilots die during ejection is a late decision to get out of the jet. They spend too much time trying to save the airplane. I will wake up over the water, not sure how I got there, why I'm there, where I am, have no idea why I'm going faster than I have ever gone in an F-15 before, and approaching 10,000 feet, I will go back to all the training that we have received for over 2.5 years of flying pointy nose jets in the Air Force. I see 10,000 feet coming through. I reach down with both hands to the outside of my thighs. I grab the yellow ejection handles and I make the decision to pull the handles. We always say you're a dead man when you pull the ejection handles. If everything goes well, you'll be alive at the end of it. There's no guarantee you're not going to be injured, especially when you're at high speed, but you're going to have a chance. When
I leave, by this time, you were doing over the Mach, right? You were doing 1.1, somewhere in there?
I am Mach 1.13, which sounds real impressive, but the Mach is just a ratio number. It's kind of black magic voodoo. What matters is think about your dog with his head stuck out the window of the pickup at 60 mile an hour and his jowls flapping in the wind. On the airspeed indicator, I have an indicated airspeed of 735 mile an hour, 640 knots. And that wind speed is going to generate over 1,500 pounds per square foot of air pressure. The ejection sequence will immediately release the canopy. The seat will come up the rails, and 0.3 seconds after I pull the handles, I will be exposed to that 1,500 pounds per square foot of air pressure. It will slam my head back against the headrest. My shoulder harnesses will automatically lock my torso in against the seat. As the seat comes above the canopy rail, my left arm gets exposed to the wind. It will immediately blow straight backwards 180 degrees behind me. In the process, it hits the oxygen bottle on the left-hand side of the seat. We call that an ACES II signature fracture because that will break my forearm, the radius and the ulna in three locations. It'll break the head of my humerus in my shoulder joint and dislocate my shoulder. So now my left arm is basically pointed straight behind me 180 degrees. The air flowing around my helmet will flow down to my shoulder blades, which are being held against the seat due to the inertial reels, which lock you into position. The air will catch the back of the helmet, feed the helmet off my head from backwards to forwards, and then once it clears my head will get slammed back against the seat for the second time in less than half a second. The wind on my lower legs, on the front of my shin bones, is 1,500 pounds on each leg. That will compress my calf muscles so severely that both lower leg joints will dislocate out the back of the knee sockets. The right leg, lower right leg, will come up over the edge of the seat. Even though it's designed to retain the legs in high speed, I am going faster than the speed limit of the seat. And it's not because the seat fails at 600 knots, which is the speed limit. The human body starts to fail at about 450 knots, and above 600, it's really not considered survivable. My lower right leg will eventually end up around my right rib cage. I am lucky in the sense that my lower left leg will follow my right leg. Because if it had not, it would have split my pelvis when it went the other direction. I would have bled out. And unfortunately, there was a Strike Eagle crew about a year later, and the back seat are almost the exact same aerodynamic conditions, was killed in those for that exact reason. Lucky to say, Brian Udell, the front seater, did survive. So my right leg will blow to the right-hand side of the seat. It will hit the brace that's designed to contain your legs. It will break my lower left leg in five spots. That'll be a compound fracture, tear a hole in the side of my calf. And now my right foot will come up over the right side of the seat. So I now have both feet up by my right side. I say basically kicking me for being stupid and falling asleep. While this is going on, a four-foot drogue chute will deploy. All of this is less than 1 second, and that four-foot drogue chute is going to slow me and my ejection seat as a unit is going to slow me down from over 735 mile an hour to 200 mile an hour in a time of 1.3 seconds. That's a little more than 45 G's out the front of my body. Now, G's out the front or straight through the back of your body, like you would experience in a car crash, the body can handle a tremendous amount of G's there. But realize all these arms and legs that have flown back are now thrown forward again, and then I get opening shock. They get hit one more time, and now I will peacefully start to drift down into the Gulf of Mexico. Mm. How are we doing so far, Spad?
And so all of that that you just described happened in a matter of a couple of seconds, and now you're at roughly 10,000 feet or so drifting down to the Gulf, but I imagine you were knocked unconscious during the ejection. So you G-locked, came to, ejected, and now you're back out again during this whole sequence. Is that right?
That's pretty close. I pulled the handles at 10,000 feet. What we talked about in the last 5 minutes took place in 2.2 seconds, and I had a full chute by the time I was at 8,000 feet.
Okay.
Now, people may stop and think, wow, you had time to save this airplane. If you look at the emergency dive recovery charts, which is idle, speed break, wings level, 10G pull, I could have executed that for about the next 8 to 10 seconds and missed the ocean, assuming I did not put myself back asleep or break the jet trying to do it. The jet went into the water 15 seconds after I pulled the handles.
Yeah, and the other thing I would also remind people is you were just unconscious. When you come back to consciousness, to your point, you get it in stages. And it's not as if you're fully there and everything's fully cognitive ability and all that. You're still working through some fog of what happened. Where am I? It's very much like waking up. If you've ever done that, you know, wake up in a hotel room. You've been traveling so much, you're not even quite sure where you are. So imagine, you know, going through that process. So there's another factor, and that's why the Air Force recommends exactly what you did, which is at 10,000 feet uncontrolled, you eject. It's the speed at which you're hurling towards the ground and your cognitive ability to process it, especially after coming from a G-lock, is very difficult.
It is. And again, it just goes back to our training. And that's another thing that I stress to people. And it really doesn't matter what environment I'm speaking, whether it's to other pilots, professionals in medical practice, or just talking to businessmen, is we all have training. We all have fundamentals that you have to be able to go back to without thinking about it. And it's important to always review those. And whether it's single engine airplanes takeoff right afterwards, am I going straight ahead? How much can I turn? Whether it's dealing with an in-cabin electrical malfunction, or even something with your car, driving down the road and something, you know, runs out in front of you, that deer. It's like, no, we're not going to be swerving. We're going to slow down as much as we can and take it straight ahead instead of rolling the car through the ditch. But
your experience, John, really reinforces that adage that in a crisis situation or in a pressure situation, you don't rise to the occasion, you fall to the level of your training. And really what you relied on here that saved your life was hours and hours of training, wrote all that time that we did. And we made fun of when we were in the Air Force, how much time we had to go through the G-lock training and the centrifuges and the practicing the ejection sequence and the sit posture and all that stuff. and you fell back to your level of training, and it saved your life.
We did, Spad, you know, and we all made fun of it, like you said. Why? Because, A, we're type A personalities. It's not going to happen to us. But the fact is, the Navy and the Air Force did some studies. About 12% of pilots have known they have G-locked. But we also know in the centrifuge, 50% of those who experience a G-induced loss of consciousness do not remember it. And so we know it's a threat out there. Now, we always said it's not going to happen to me, but if it does, we're lucky that we were able to take advantage of the best training in the U.S. military. So here I am. I'm now floating down in the canopy over the Gulf of Mexico. My eyes have swollen shut because my face has taken such a beating from the wind that I cannot see. You asked about whether I was conscious, and while I don't recall the parachute descent, we know that a half hour after I land in the water, I am conscious. How that happens is I go into the Gulf of Mexico, and we had what's called saltwater activated releases, or called SeaWars. These are three explosive charges on our parachute harness. Two of them are on our parachute risers. When you go into the water, you give it about a 2 count, and basically it's a 12-gauge shotgun shell, which detonates, releases our parachute, and it keeps us from being drugged either in the wind or drugged down into the water when the canopy sinks. The third LPU, or the third SeaWars, is connected to our LPU, which is a life preserver unit. It's the old Mae West life preserver, not unlike the one you get underneath your seat on the airlines. It's a little more robust. It automatically inflated. You know, I don't care what anybody's personal beliefs are, but the reason I'm here today is because the good Lord wasn't ready for me. Because, unfortunately, a lot of the LPUs will get destroyed in super high speed ejections, or they will tear away from the harness behind our neck. And we've improved those as we have found that through mishaps. But there was a good chance that my LPU would not have been there to save me. But on this day, it fully inflated. And because of my injuries, I will float almost 2 hours in the Gulf of Mexico, just being held face up by this Mae West life preserver.
And you remember that, John? You were fully conscious during that, or is that a part that you also don't remember?
I do not remember.
Yeah. But so you wouldn't have had, you don't remember it, but given all the injuries that you described from your ejection sequence, you would not have had the ability to move your arms and legs and keep yourself afloat anyway. You were basically, thank God for those life preservers, because you had no other ability to stay afloat.
I was absolutely at the mercy of our life support troops, and you know how important those are. One of the really neat things was about 2 years later, I gave a graduation address at the United States Air Force Survival Instructor School. And while I'm standing in front of a couple hundred parents, families, friends, loved ones, spouses, telling them how important the job and the career field that their loved ones have undertaken, I got to turn around to the chief master sergeant of the school. His name was Chief House. A big of a man. I turned around and I snapped the sharpest salute I could to that chief master sergeant, because he was on the initial cadre that helped develop that SeaWars device that saved my life.
Great story. I bet that was a really moving moment for him. So you're floating in the water, and I guess by then they had launched the rescue, but it took them a while. You were fair ways out over the Gulf, so it took them a couple of hours to reach you, right?
So I was 50 miles south of Apalachicola, Florida, out in what we call Whiskey 151 Bravo. The Coast Guard immediately started getting a Dauphine helicopter headed that way. They also put a Falcon jet over the top of me. Of course, the other F-15s went into what we call Cap patrol, guy down low trying to keep sight of me, trying to get me on the radio, a guy flying up high to save fuel and to be the radio relay back to the ground units. The Coast Guard jet dropped basically a navigation buoy close to me. I was about 4 miles to the west of the wreckage of the airplane. I was never able to pop my sea dive markers. I couldn't get on the radio. I couldn't get into my life raft due to my injuries. I couldn't pop flare, use my signal mirror. So they were having a really tough time staying visual with me. And two or three times during the first hour before a C-130 out of Hurlburt Air Force Base, the Special Ops Wing, got there, they actually lost sight of me in the water. And now there's two eagles line abreast, 1 mile apart at 1,000 feet, running back and forth over an initial navigation system hack, trying to find me again. Of course, initially, they didn't think I was even alive. And what happened was at the 30-minute mark, you and I know that we do all our weapons testing down at Eglin Air Force Base and Tyndall Air Force Base, and they have Huey helicopters there. But they're not rescue helicopters. They do have a hoist on them because they pick up wreckage from the subscale drones we shoot. Well, this helicopter went and hovered over the top of me. It got there, the first true on-scene, low-altitude, slow aircraft. And I waved to it at the 30-minute mark. And that's when everybody realized we actually have a survivor in the water. And you can imagine how that made everybody feel, because up to this point, the word was that I did not get out of the jet. Initial indications that my instructor never saw me eject. He was too far behind me.
Up to that point, they were thinking it was recovery, not rescue. And then now they realize they got a rescue on their hands.
Exactly. So about this time, an MH-53 Pavlo out of the 20th Special Operations Squadron at Hurlburt Airfield, just out to the west of Tyndall, had just come back from a functional check flight. It had just done some heavy maintenance. They went out and they have to do a big maintenance test card. It passed, and they had called up this crew and said, hey, we need you to come back and land. They landed on what we call the hot pit. And Spad, you remember those days where what it is the helicopter lands next to the fuel pump. They don't even shut down the engines. While the engines are run and they pump it full of fuel, two pararescues, or PJs, these are our Air Force Special Ops troops, that their only job is to go into combat and pull out downed pilots. They sprint across the airfield with their two bags. One of them is home because he's going to deploy to the downrange the next day. The other one, Ken Fournay, is home because his wife is due with her first baby. They're going to sprint into the helicopter. The helicopter is going to get out to me at about the two-hour mark. Ken Fournay is a senior airman. He has just finished PJ school, and he is about to step out the door on his first live rescue.
Is this, by the way, time of year? Was weather, was chill, cold a factor, or what?
It's now 12:15 a.m. May 5th of 94. So it's about 75 degree water and about 75 degree air. We've got 2 to 3 foot seas. So it's a pretty nice day if you have to be floating in the Gulf of Mexico half dead. Ken jumps out of the helicopter, and you and I remember our training that before a helicopter comes in to rescue, you want to sink your raft or fill it full of water so that it doesn't get kicked up by the rotor wash. Well, obviously, with only one good arm, two bad legs, and blind, I can't do that. And as Ken jumps out of this helicopter about 30 feet above me, he goes into the water right beside me, and the Coast Guard has this on film. Well, about the time he comes back up above water, my raft has got sucked up in the tail wash and the rotor wash of this Pavlo helicopter, and I'm tied to it still with that 25-foot tether. It misses the tail rotor by about 10 feet, and I get blown about 200 feet out the back of this helicopter through the water. So the gunner points back to where I am. Ken grabs his great big bag of gear, and he starts swimming. He gets to me, and I complain to him that my leg hurts and that I can't see. Well, he goes, your eyes are just swollen up, and your leg's a little bit banged up. So I always give him a bad time and say, if a PJ's talking to you, he's probably lying, but I'll still buy him all the whiskey he wants. And Ken and I have had several good conversations and several good glasses of whiskey since. Ken's going to spend about the next 20 minutes putting me onto a backboard, taking all the C-spine precautions that you would for somebody who's gone through a horrific, traumatic event. They're going to lower a Stokes stretcher into the water, and then they will start to hoist me up. So 2 hours and 20 minutes after I go into the Gulf of Mexico, I am now laying on the floor of this MH-53 going 150 mile an hour back towards the coast with two PJs working on me. They make the decision, instead of taking me to Tyndall Air Force Base, they take me straight to Eglin Air Force Base, land on the helipad outside the hospital, roll me straight into the ER. They're going to spend a couple hours there stabilizing me, putting some blood into me, trying to get me warmed up, stabilizing the dislocated joints and broken arms and legs. A really neat thing is about 15 years later, while we were doing one of the TV shows telling this story, I got to go back to that same hospital, and one of the original nurses that was there that day is now retired from the Air Force, a civilian nurse working in that same ER, and we got to have a fun reunion and tell the stories, or let her tell her version of what it was like to have me roll in that day. Wow. They will then medevac me to Keesler Air Force Base, Biloxi, Mississippi. That's one of our regional trauma centers. And I will spend the next 3 months in that location going through multiple surgeries, starting to get stabilized. Bottom line, it's going to take a year to fix my broken leg. We're going to have to do a bone graft surgery where we glue it together. It's going to take another year of going to Dr. Mark Miller at the Air Force Academy to fix my broken knees. And then 9 months of medical processes and waivers. And throughout this time, Spad, the most important thing was it was every single day take a small step forward. And it was pretty easy to do that when it was all the physical stuff. I could push myself through PT as much as I want. But just like everybody right now dealing with this coronavirus, they're not in control. And once it got to where it was in the medical field process for 9 months, I was no longer in control. And you know, as fighter pilots, we like to be in control. And the advice I have to everybody out there is when you feel like things are getting out of control or you don't have as much as you would like, that's when you need to speak up. You need to let people know that this is bothering me, whether it's depression, whether it's pain, whether it's just a sense of hopelessness. Talking to people, because I guarantee you somebody around you within 5 minutes, I can find somebody in a worse situation. When I was in the hospital, there was a four-year-old boy. I want to say his name was Riley. He had terminal cancer. He was the happiest kid every single day that I think I have ever seen, despite he knew he was going to die. And I always use him as my example. And on days that I'm struggling, and I still struggle with chronic pain and a lot of other things, I stop and I think of that young boy. And I tell people, look around. There's somebody that has it worse than you. And it may not be some big drastic event like we're describing here. It may be the high school senior right now that didn't get a run in their track championship. It might be the young girl who was excited to go to her first prom. It might be the businessman who put all his blood, sweat, tears, and investment into his business, and now he is not sure how it's going to make it. It might be the young kid that just finally got his private pilot's license, was working on his commercial instrument, and now the industry is at a standstill, and he doesn't know, can I even continue my training? Is there a career for me to go to?
Well, you're a pretty remarkable story and persistence yourself, because they told you that there was no way you were going to fly again. You would be lucky to walk again. And 4 or 5 years later, I don't remember exactly the time frame, you were back flying the Eagle again.
It did take me. I was very fortunate there, Spad. You know, a lot of times the doctors will give you the worst case scenario, and they were worried about bone infection in that leg that had been exposed to the salt water all that time. Luckily, the bone infection and bone cancer has never developed, and I was able to get back and after 3 years, go back, and I basically restarted my Air Force career. I went and I flew the F-15 in Alaska, went down to Navy Pensacola on the exchange and instructed down there. Went back to fly F-15s at Mountain Home, Idaho, went over to Korea, ran the entire Korean Peninsula safety program for the Air Force, and then I was fortunate enough to finish my career teaching in T-38s and passing on to the next generation of fighter pilots, not only how to fly a good jet, but what it meant to be a good officer, what it meant to be a good wingman, not just in the air, but on the ground for your squadron mates and everything else. And hopefully I have served as a pretty good example for people. You know, none of us are perfect, and there's a lot of things that I probably would have done different had I had a chance to do it again. But I was fortunate enough that I was able to just keep at it. And it's small steps.
Perseverance and a positive attitude, and that's what I know of you since I've known you. And now it's just a whole lot of fun to see you, having gone through that and not just survived, but really thrived through it, got back to a successful career. And you're having a whole lot of fun flying that 170 in the backcountry. I'm loving your Facebook posts.
Yeah, we are having a lot of fun, and I'll give the shameless plug there, but if anybody wants to go see what we're doing, YouTube, Jughead Counsell, and me and my dog Dakota, if we're not out hunting pheasants or quail, we're out landing on the sandbars, out in the farm country, out in the high desert, exploring the mountains, looking for whales, and just having all sorts of fun. And one of the neat things is it's not just me going out and doing things, but you know, I've had people come to me that say, hey, I want to get into backcountry flying, or I want to buy a 170, and guiding them through a 2-3 year process to where we find them an airplane, we bring it home, we teach them to fly it, and then you take them out and you help them land on the very first sandbar. And that's been just as rewarding as a lot of the other really neat things that we've done in our career. And you and I have both got to do some really neat stuff. I mean, how often do you get to dive through the Golden Gate Bridge at noon with smoke on and skydivers coming down like I've done with the Patriots? And, of course, you've flown over everything as Thunderbird lead. But sunrise on a riverbed or up in the mountains and sleeping under the wing of your airplane, there's just nothing beats that. And that's the neat thing is whether I'm flying my airplane, flying my fighter jet, flying people at work, the trick is go out and fly the best jet you can. And that means you practice, practice, practice. It means you always are getting better by asking people who know more. The other day, you know, I had to call up the 24-year-old veteran of doing a certain type of neat off-airport flying, Bobby Breeden, and go, hey, you're one of the few guys I know that have flown the airplane off of a cliff. What do I need to know that I haven't thought about? And he gave me some great guidance. We went out and we had a good time flying the airplane off the cliff.
Yeah, I share your love of the backcountry flying. And you and I share the same background. We both got our start in GA. And I have a great deal to be thankful for general aviation in my life and what it's provided me throughout my life and yours as well. And it's fun that even after a professional career, we can still maintain that joy and the connection to general aviation. There's so much to it and so much enjoyment. Well, Jughead, I want to thank you so much for sharing your story with us. It's one that I had heard, of course, a couple times. I know our audience is going to be really intrigued by your story and to hear your personal account. So thanks so much, and I look forward to seeing you out on the circuit soon.
Well, Spad and Warren, and thank you very much, and I can't thank AOPA and everything that you guys do for the pilots, the pilot protection services, the advocacy for the entire general aviation world. I've been a proud member my whole life, and it's really been my honor to bring this very small story out there, and hopefully it does help somebody. And if you're out there and you've got questions, you want to reach out to me, either get a hold of AOPA or look me up on Facebook or at Jughead Counsell on YouTube and JughedF15 at Yahoo, and I'll be sure to reach out to you, because it's important that we pass on to the next generation what I have benefited from those who have mentored me.
Thanks, buddy. Great talking to you.
See you, Spad.